Now, you had a pretty heavy-duty one, so do you want to share that?
Well, sure. You must be talking about my night on the mountain.
That's the one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well.
And by the way, how long had you been there before this happened?
Well, I got there in early April of 68, and then this happened in July
mm-hmm.
of 68.
Mm-hmm.
And by that time, I was a member of a combination recon and ambush team. That's why they changed the long-range recon patrol designation to long-range patrol, because we were doing more than just recon.
I see.
Part of us were doing nothing but going out and setting ambushes.
Okay.
So, but at that time, yeah, we were involved in a recon of an area in the tri-border area of Cambodia, Laos, and Vietnam, South Vietnam, and we were sent to overlook a mountain range that was being fed off of the Ho Chi Minh trails, that system of trails that was running north and south out of North Vietnam, down through Laos and into Cambodia. And we started out early that day, and we climbed and climbed and climbed. We spent most of that day just trying to get to the top of this mountain. And if I remember right, no, we did make it to the top of that mountain in the first day. And when we got up there, we ran into a trail, and that was the trail we were headed for. And it was what we would call a high-speed trail.
Meaning
it was wide enough and had been used enough that the trail itself was hard-packed. It was probably a meter wide, about 39 inches wide, 40 inches wide, which was a high-speed trail.
That's not very wide.
That's a high-speed trail for those little guys.
What were they, about 110 pounds soaking wet?
If they even weighed that. If they even weighed that.
To them, you must have been a jolly green giant.
We were giants to these guys.
Yeah.
They were little bitty people.
Little David and Goliath. Yeah. So, hey, you're going up this mountainside.
So we got up there, and we looked around a little bit, and we were right on the very top. And we decided, okay, this is where we need to be. We're going to set up here for the night. So we started setting out our booby traps, and we set out a system of those.
Did you have enough equipment doing all that hiking and everything? You were equipped.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Each guy carried his enough freeze-dried rations to last the entire time we were out there. Each guy carried four canteens of water. Each guy carried plenty of grenades, and we had our backpacks. Each guy carried at least 2 to 3 claymore mines, and each one of us had we carried det cord, which was an explosive cord, small, a little bit smaller than the size of a pencil, and this stuff would blow at about 1,500 feet a second, I think it was.
Wow.
It was 1,500 feet in less than a second. But anyway, we carried that to utilize in our ambushes, and we had smoke grenades and white phosphorus grenades. So we had all of this, and of course we had lots of ammunition for our M16s and our CAR-15s that we carried.
Just to interrupt for just a minute, let's see, did you think you were going to come home?
No, I did not at that time.
Did you think you're just pressing the envelope?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, and you were?
Yes.
You were. Okay, so you're up on that mountain setting your ambushes.
Yep, we set up the ambush and got all that set up, and then We moved back from the trail. It was the trail was below us and to the west of us, and we moved back up to the top of that mountain, which we were probably about, oh, I think about maybe 150, 200 yards from that that trail, and then we started setting up our claymores, our perimeter, and then we just settled in for the night.
Stars are shining.
Yeah, you know, and it was kind of nice because in the triple canopy, you didn't usually get to see the stars, but we were right on top of this mountain, so, you know, the trees weren't all that thick up there.
Maybe it was a little bit too quiet and creepy.
I don't know. I was thinking, I'm high enough. I'm getting closer to God. Maybe this is a good sign.
There
you
go. False sign.
Yeah.
So then.
Well, everything was quiet until sometime after dark. I fell asleep, and we had one guy that was awake.
He had to be tired.
Watching. Oh, we were tired. Yeah, those mountains were so steep. They're just, you know. I mean, we were in good shape, but still, you're carrying around an average of 75, 80 pound pack, and you're going up and, you know, climbing these steep mountains up there.
They were steep.
Oh yeah.
No paved roads.
Pardon?
No paved roads.
No paved roads.
No.
Well, no, there's only dirt roads. But yeah, long after I went to sleep, sometime after I went to sleep, I was awakened, and one of the guys said, the guy that was spotted the lights, he said, okay, we've got a system of lights, and they're headed right for us. Mm. And they were coming out of the Cambodia Laotian area, and it was just I could not believe how far those lights went, and I didn't realize up until that point just how in depth that trail system was coming out of that country.
Now, lights. What kind of lights?
Well, they were flashlights and also lanterns. And we figured an average of 4 to 5 guys between the lights. Mm. And these lights went for I don't know, it was 2.5 to 3 miles, maybe even further. They were just coming from a long ways down in there, and we knew that, okay, you know, eventually they're going to be coming right by us, so we've got to stop.
You were awakened out of your beauty sleep.
Oh yeah, there was no more. I wasn't tired now.
What do you do?
Well, the first thing we did is we got out our red light, our flashlight. You know, we carried flashlights with the red lens, and we started looking at our maps, and we drew an azimuth, and we got we took the coordinates, the direction of the azimuth from us to the
azimuth is what?
Compass azimuth, okay. And we relayed that information back to Playmorong. And that was the fire base, and so they started shelling.
Okay, they're inside Vietnam.
They're inside Vietnam,
yeah, uh-huh,
yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they were.
And what if they weren't?
Are you? I was talking about the fire base was inside.
Oh,
Vietnam.
I'm sorry. I meant the Viet Cong.
Oh, the Viet Cong.
Uh-huh.
The Viet Cong were coming out of. It was a combination Viet Cong and hardcore North Vietnamese regiment troops.
Are they across the border coming in?
They were across the border coming in. They were coming up through that trail system.
So your fire base fire over the board, or didn't matter? Is that it?
Well, yeah, it didn't matter.
Okay.
And they were actually dropping rounds just inside of South Vietnam, and right on the very edge.
How do you even know where the border is?
Well, you map coordinates.
It's a moot point, but anyway.
It's a moot point. Yeah.
Were you? It sounds like you guys were keeping pretty cool under pressure.
Well, at that point, there wasn't a whole lot of pressure to us. We were just watching these lights and knowing that the artillery people are gonna bombard these people, mm-hmm. and we'll just take it from there and see what happens. Maybe they'll disperse. Maybe they'll stop. Maybe they'll won't move any further. But that wasn't the case.
But dispersing could be a worse problem.
Yes.
Continue.
So they started throwing the artillery at them, and immediately the lights went out, and the artillery just kept coming and coming, and it went on for, I don't know, it must have went on for an hour and a half, 2 hours, and then they called us back and said, okay, we're gonna shut it down, let us know what happens. So we waited after they shut it down, and it wasn't long after that and the lights came back on, and they kept moving because they were under orders. They had a mission too,
yeah.
Creepy. So this went on all night long. And
Again, was it nonstop shelling, or they'd wait, stop, proceed? The artillery.
Yeah, the artillery would fire artillery for anywhere from 45 minutes to an hour, hour and a half. And then they would stop. And then we'd wait. A little bit later, the lights would come on.
So it's just a game.
It was just a game.
Back and forth.
Okay, and they were trying to see what the enemy was going to do. And the enemy, they found out, was not going to stop.
Amazing.
So eventually, the shelling stopped, and it was just about daybreak. The shelling had been stopped for a while, and so we were just kind of waiting to see what was going to happen.
But you didn't know where they would be at that point in daylight.
No, we figured we had already known by that time they were not going to stop.
But I mean, coming your way.
Coming our way. We didn't know if they were going to exactly come our way, but we had an idea that intelligence had an idea that these people were gonna come in, and they were going to move south. Mm-hmm. And so south meant they would come our way. They mm-hmm. wouldn't. They wouldn't take the trail and head north.
I'll let you continue,
Well, we just waited, and I was asleep again. I'd already spent my time watching and calling in artillery throughout the night a couple different times, and by daybreak I was asleep. And no, as a matter of fact, I'm sorry, I was not asleep. I was sitting there leaning up against a tree, and the other three guys were asleep. And I heard a grenade go off. One of our booby traps went off. Mm. I was awake, that's right. Mm. And anyway, it went off, and it was kind of funny because the other two guys, two of the guys sat up, and the other guy kind of raised his head, and we listened, and what we thought we heard the moaning of an animal. Mm-hmm. And we thought, well, maybe a wild pig had run into our booby trap.
Why didn't you think it was one of them?
It didn't sound like it. It sounded more like an animal mm-hmm. that was moaning. Mm-hmm. And so we listened to that for a little while, and then it finally stopped, and we thought, well, we should go over there and take a look anyway. So one of the guys went over, and he came back real quickly, and he said, let's go. So th- three of us went down there, and we left one guy with the radio, and we went down there and to the trail, and we had a Viet Cong laying there. Remember, he had a blue shirt and black pajamas, bottoms, and his regular, what we call go-aheads, his footwear. They were like thongs that they used. And he had a weapon.
Would you have any idea how old he may have been? Hard to tell, huh?
It was hard to tell. It was hard to tell. He was messed up pretty bad, anyway, from that grenade. But I remember the first thing I spotted, that was an M2 carbine.
Which means one of yours?
It was what our troops used in Korea.
How did
this
that
short M2 carbine.
How did that happen?
I don't know. They had all kinds of weapons over there. But and it was broken up pretty bad with the shrapnel and everything. So we were checking out. He had a backpack on. I remember Gary Mead was our team leader, and he was going through the backpack, and that's when this Viet Cong's buddies, it was kind of like a forward recon unit that was out in front of this this big movement of enemy troops that ran into that booby trap. Well, they jumped up. There was two or three of them jumped up, and we had a firefight, and we took them down, and then
close
a couple
range.
Other guys. Oh yeah, they were just within just a few feet of us. And then a couple more jumped up, and we had another firefight, and we took those guys down. And then we grabbed what we could and ran back. And the team leader went all the way back to where the RTO was, and because he needed to call in. And so myself and the other guy that I was with, Bill Fowler from LA, jumped behind a log. And I remember I went a little bit further. He spotted the log first and jumped behind it, and I went a little bit further, and I turned to get behind the log with him, and I got tangled up in all these vines, and I was fighting with this and fighting with that, and I finally got over there. And so we fired a few rounds back and forth, traded shots at these guys. And,
just something out of a movie.
I wasn't thinking movie at that time, but I was thinking, man, here we go. Here we go again.
This is for real.
Yeah. So this went on for quite some time.
Like, when you say quite some time, like an hour?
Yeah, let's see. That was all just after daybreak, and I think Bill and I were down there till around noon, because these guys were moving in around us.
Wait a minute, you were constantly doing combat?
Yeah.
All that time?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
you'd trade a shot. They'd trade a shot, and they would try to get close. But see, at the time, we were also calling in artillery. That's what Gary did when he got back to the RTO.
Mm-hmm. Was it working?
It was working for a while, mm-hmm. until the enemy got the idea, okay, we need to move closer to them.
Now, at this point around noontime, you'd already seen the lights from the night before.
Yes.
You had to think you're a dead duck.
Didn't think we were going to get out of there.
No.
None of us did.
No,
I mean, it was just, there were just way too many people, although we had no idea exactly how bad it was. We knew there was a lot of people in the area.
Are you talking like maybe a division, battalion?
It was a, it turned out to be an estimated 1,500 estimated 1,500 enemy movement, because after this was all over and said and done, we got word that high-altitude recon aircraft had been photographing that area for 2 weeks, and they estimated, and they gave us an estimate of 1,500 body count.
Wow.
And, of course, we didn't kill all those guys ourselves. I mean, you know, we killed so many, but the artillery we called in destroyed that entire movement. It was really, I mean, it just, we knew that it was a lot. We knew that it was several hundred, but we had no idea it was, you know, that it was 1,500, because they photographed them carrying their dead out of that area for 2 weeks.
That is amazing. And this all took place within a matter of a day.
About 18 hours. I figured it was 18 hours we were pinned down.
Okay, getting back to you, now you're still pretty much in your same location.
Yes.
Doing this combat back and forth.
Yes.
Now, at this point, you were seeing all of them and within range of each other, and you're just...
Well,
visualize what you're seeing here.
You're shooting at... You're seeing glimpses of them, and you're seeing the spot they're shooting from, so you'd be shooting back.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd shoot at glimpses of them moving around, because they were trying to flank us. Mm-hmm. That's what they were trying
to
do.
Well, you're going to run out of ammunition.
Mm-hmm. So we weren't constantly shooting. We were under the gun, so to speak.
Mm-hmm.
But we were running low of ammunition.
Of course.
We were running low.
Now, during all this time, you're having the artillery and planes coming in? Or what was the overhead?
No, there were no planes coming in, because they wouldn't come in as long as the artillery was being fired.
I see.
So eventually, it seemed like it was around 11 o'clock in the morning, something like that, that the team leader snuck back down to where Bill and I were, and he said, "We've got to move back. They want us to try to break and run."
Mm-hmm.
And so we retreated to where our little camp was, and when we got back there, they said, "Okay," team leader said, "The deal is they want us to try to break and run and get out of here if we can escape this. So don't worry about packing anything up. We're just gonna, we want both radios." But he said, "When I give you the sign, we will blow all of our claymores. And once we blow the claymores, we're gonna jump up and run, and we're gonna head this direction, back down. We're gonna go, which would have been northeast of our location, and back down this real steep mountain." And so we got ready, and we left everything, our backpacks, except the two guys with radios. We put those on, and we blew all the claymores, and we jumped and ran. And if I remember right, I don't think we even got 50 yards off the top of that little knoll right there on top of that mountain.
Now, at this point, were you kind of defenseless?
We didn't feel defenseless. Mm-hmm. We felt that we had the full cooperation of the artillery. Mm-hmm. But at that point, the artillery, they had walked the artillery within 25 meters of us.
Mm.
And 25 meters is like 75 feet or so, but you have to understand exactly where we were in relation to where they were dropping this artillery. They were dropping it in front of us and around us, kind of like in a semicircle around us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and they weren't dropping it behind us.
Mm-hmm.
And we kept trying to walk it in closer, and our final contact with the Arty people was, they said, we cannot drop another five meters, because it's going to be right on top of you.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, we had chunks of shrapnel that were bouncing off the trees falling around us that was setting some of the leaves and stuff to ground cover on fire.
Unbelievable.
And it was scary. It was loud. It was just, it was surreal. At that point, it became very surreal. And
it sounded like be disorienting.
It was, but we were trying to focus on the next objective, which was to escape. And we figured we had an open area to the northeast of us, behind us, and off of that steep part of that mountain that we had come up on from the day before. And so anyway, we blew our claymores and we jumped, and we might have made 50 yards, 60 yards, something like that, and we took a lot of heavy fire, and I don't know how many grenades that were thrown at us from that direction, and we realized at that point we are completely surrounded. Yeah. This has been going on all night long, and they have snuck around behind us. Mm. So here we are. And it was
just pinned down.
We were pinned down on a very steep mountain, and right in front of us and just below us was an area of, it was almost like a very shallow ditch that might have been 5 yards wide, and it was where during the monsoons the rainwater had washed and it would run down the mountain that way, and you know, kind of at an angle down the side of this mountain range, and that was right in front of us, and there was I remember there was bamboo up there, there was a lot of trees, but it wasn't triple canopy. It was we could see lots of the sky, and the bad thing about it was when we stopped, I slid with both of my legs underneath me, and at that point we just froze, and we were afraid to even move because they were so close to us. We didn't want to give away our exact position, and I could feel after a little while my legs were starting to go numb. Mm-hmm. And I was trying to look behind me because I was afraid they were going to come right over top of the mountain and down on top of us. Mm-hmm. And follow our trail, which, you know, when you're running that fast, you're not covering your trail. So I thought, this is it. Mm-hmm. They're going to come right on top of us. So
you remembering this so vividly.
It's almost like a running negative, like a film that, is just burned into your memory.
The detailed description is remarkable.
Well,
and that was almost 50 years ago.
That was 50 years ago, but you have to understand, we were trained in detail. On those missions, we were heavily trained to remember just about everything we saw. Mm-hmm. And I could remember the ground cover and the trees and the bamboo, the sparse bamboo that was in the area. Mm-hmm. And I can remember the shots being fired, the grenades being thrown at us that were bouncing off of some of the trees and that were falling back on the enemy.
Were you having any flashbacks of your life at that point, or was it just too much going on?
There was just too much going on. No. It was just totally focused. Mm-hmm. It was listening to the radio. It was giving our people on the other end of that radio information. Mm-hmm. And we told them, basically we said, this is it, we can't move, we're surrounded. Mm-hmm. We're totally surrounded. You got to come and get us.
You got to get us out of here.
And they were hearing us. Mm-hmm. Oh yes. And so they said, they told us to wait one, and then they called back within just a few seconds and said, we're going to start the artillery, give us some more coordinates. Mm-hmm. So we started walking artillery down the side of that mountain and all around behind us and below us, and then it got extremely loud again. The smoke was you know, it's just filling the top of the mountain again, and...
What would those be, like 155s?
Or 155s, one... Mm-hmm. They were 155s coming out
big.
Of Plamoran, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They were either 155s or 175s. It could have been 175. Matter of fact, I think they were, because Plamoran was about 30 miles from us, from where we were at right there. Mm-hmm. So they had to have been, I'm pretty sure, 175s. Mm-hmm. I know they were big. They made a lot of noise coming through the sky. And
doing some damage.
Doing some damage. Mm-hmm. And eventually, this went on for, I don't know, this went on for a couple hours, and then the artillery stopped, and they called us, and they said, we're sending a rescue. We're sending an extraction. Well, they came in. Some
now, that was a heroic effort in itself, I'm assuming.
That was a big heroic effort. These helicopters came in on the first wave. I don't remember counting them. I just remember all of a sudden they came up the mountain, and they were there, and they circled the mountain, and they just raised hell.
It must have been a sight.
Oh, it was. And you know, you get that many helicopters, that many miniguns going, it's just extremely noisy. And this went around and around for a long time, and
they knew exactly where you were.
They didn't. They were trying to spot us. They were having trouble. They were having trouble seeing us because of the smoke from their rockets, mm-hmm. and of course the residual smoke from the artillery that had stopped just a little bit before they got in range, mm-hmm. and eventually we tried to signal them with a mirror. We tried to signal them with our international orange flag. They couldn't find us, and all of a sudden they were gone, and we heard them, they were leaving, and we called them, and he said, what's going on, where are you going, we're still here. And they said, we run out of ammunition, we're running out of fuel. We have to get out of the area so we can get the artillery back in there, and we will do something, but we're coming back to get you.
No man left behind.
And we thought at that point, they'll never make it. Mm-hmm. These people are—they're within 25 meters or less of us,
but
right
they're
now.
They're still coming at you.
They're still coming at us.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, of course, they hunkered down during all that assault onto them. They weren't moving, and they were getting chopped up pretty bad.
But they could assume that you're still out there somewhere.
Oh yeah, they knew we were there. Mm-hmm. They knew we were there. They knew that no helicopter had gotten onto the ground to pick us up, and there was no way they could chopper could land.
Right.
It was just the terrain was just not compatible. Mm-hmm. So it was so scary at that point. We just figured they're not going to make it. Mm-hmm. They're not going to make it back. We're not going to get out of here. Best we can do is whatever we can do.
Were you praying at that point, or are you just still focused?
Still focused.
Okay.
Still
Boy,
focused.
That's painful. That'd be in a fetal position.
Yeah.
Anyway.
So anyway, they started the artillery once the choppers got out of the area. The artillery started coming back in, and this went on. After the first wave left us, it must have been around, I'm thinking around 2:30 in the afternoon by that time.
Gosh.
And so then the artillery started up again, and this went on till around 4:30, I'm thinking around 4 o'clock, another two and a half hours.
Did you have water?
We had water, but we weren't drinking, because just to make a move, mm-hmm. just to make a move to unsnap a canteen, they were so close that we were afraid to even make that kind of a noise.
I can't imagine
You know,
this.
It was like we have, if, you know, they don't know exactly where we're at, but they know within a few meters of exactly where we're at. So
frozen in place.
Frozen in place. So they were just, you know, they were sending lead downrange at us, and this stuff was zipping around and hitting the dirt and the trees and everything else. And we're just
how were you protecting yourselves? What?
There was no protection. We were just huddled
right
there. And they
still didn't hit you?
No, no.
That's a miracle.
No, it was a miracle. It was a miracle. I mean, they fired a lot of rounds at us, you know.
And they're just zinging.
They're just zinging, yeah. They're hitting the dirt and throwing dirt on us, and it's like we can't even get up and run. Because where are we going to run?
That's just amazing.
They're around behind us. They're all around us. We're, you know, they've totally circled us.
That's amazing.
It was scary.
Oh.
It was extremely frightening.
You just had to think the next bullet, it's over.
Oh, yeah.
Just over.
But, you know, my biggest fear wasn't getting hit by a bullet. My biggest fear was I going to be able to react fast enough, because I'm faced downhill with both legs underneath me. By that time, they were totally numb. I couldn't even feel them. Mm-hmm. That was my number one fear, that I'm not going to be able to jump and run. Because I'm not going to be able to, I can't feel my feet.
Well, what is that? What was that? Just that little fear? You're just numb
no, no.
from fear? Or what was
my
that?
Legs were, my legs were pinned underneath me
on this steep
mountainside.
I see.
Okay?
Yeah.
And I'm trying to keep from sliding into the guy in front of me.
I see.
You know?
I got it.
And then there's another guy in front of him. And I'm trying to, and one of the guys was right beside me like this,
so
I'm
you
trying
guys
to
are
look
just
behind me.
You're huddled together.
Yeah, uh-huh. I'm trying to look behind me to see if, am I going to be able to hit the first few guys that come over that, down through that trail we just left here a few hours ago. That was my two biggest fears.
Was there any chance of you being captured, or you'd just be dead?
We'd have been dead.
Yeah. Okay.
I think by that time, you can almost feel the energy coming from the enemy, that they are so angry, because we could hear them cussing in their language. They were mad. They were just extremely mad. We'd already killed a whole lot of their people through our firefight and calling in our artillery. They were not going to take us captive.
I mean, you couldn't get closer to hell than that.
I wouldn't think so. I really wouldn't think so.
Boy. So this is 4:30, and
around about 4:30, if I remember correctly, the artillery stopped. And as soon as it stopped, they called us and they said, your gunships are on the way. And it was really something. I have the colors in my mind's eye. I turned and I looked, and there was an open place as I was looking down at the other two guys in front of me. Looking over them, there was an open space, and I could see out through this valley for miles and miles and miles off of this mountain range. And I remember the greenery and the rolling hills below us. And I instantly spotted, I heard them first, a low rumbling. And when I looked, I saw what looked like a green snake, tiny green snake, moving across the tops of those hills. And I looked down there, and it turned out to be our two pickup ships and 14 Cobra gunships.
What a sight to behold.
And it was like a long snake, and I thought, oh my God, it's been bad, but now it's really going to get bad.
Because why?
Because those Cobra gunships, we didn't have that many Cobra gunships on the first wave. There's only a couple of them.
Oh, bad for the enemy.
Yeah.
Is what you meant. Yeah.
Bad for the enemy.
Gotcha.
It's going to get bad now. And boy, they just kind of snaked across over those hills, and they came right up and right over top of us, and they just circled that mountain. And then all hell broke loose. I mean, it got loud. You have 14 of these Cobra gunships, these Hueys. These things were just, they had their cannons, mm-hmm. Their grenade launchers. They had their miniguns, their rockets, and they just absolutely turned the mountain into nothing but white. It was just white smoke. It just, I thought hell was.
But to protect you in that one spot to be able to work around.
Oh, these guys were amazing. These guys were amazing. They were just tearing up real estate. The trees, the limbs, the stuff was just flying around in the sky all around us, and the smoke and the noise. And this just went on and on and on for, it seemed like forever, but it wasn't more than about 30, 40 minutes.
But that's long enough.
And they finally, we got a call from the first ship. What they did is the gunships are going around and around and around doing their thing, and the two pickup ships were above them waiting. And then one ship moved down to find us, and the other pickup ship stayed up there in case that first one was shot down. Okay, so they moved in, and they said, okay, we're gonna, where exactly are you? And we told them, okay, if you can see through the smoke, pick out that depression in the ground where the water runs off of the mountain. And which there was no water running at that time, but these guys knew. I mean, these pilots, they knew. They knew what those terrain features meant. And we told them, pick that out, come from the north, follow it to the south, and we'll hit you with a mirror. Mm-hmm. Or no, I said I was going to hit them with the International Orange flag first. Mm-hmm. And I remember I had put that flag back up in my pocket on my left pants, and I remember thinking, I've got to get that out, and I'm going to make noise getting that out. But then I remembered, doesn't matter, they're not going to hear me anyway, because nobody can hear anything right now. Mm-hmm. You know. So I got that out, and the ship came up, and he was right at treetop level, and it wasn't until just about the time he got right over top that I could actually see the whole helicopter through the smoke. And I tried to hit him with that flag, and he kept going, and he says, I don't see it. He said, we're going to wait until the smoke clears, and we're going to make another trip through and try to hit us with a mirror.
At this point, Gary, were they pretty much safe, secure at that point, or was there still
us?
I mean, them, the enemy, the helicopters. Well, all of you.
Well, the helicopters were not safe. No.
Okay. There's still stuff going on.
The gunships. They were still doing their thing. They were going around and around and around that mountain. Mm-hmm. But they gave the extraction ship their leeway to come up that depression to find.
So everybody's still vulnerable.
Everybody was very vulnerable. Everything was going on. The enemy, they were hiding, and I'm sure they were still shooting and trying to bring down that chase ship, or the not the chase ship, but the first extraction ship.
Sure.
Trying to get us. They were trying to, that would have been a good target for them.
Sure.
They loved to have brought that ship down.
Sure.
But anyway, he came up, and he didn't see us, so he didn't see the flag because of the smoke and everything, so he made another trip around, and he kind of slowed down, and we had a little wind up there on top of that mountain, so he waited at the right time, and he came back through, and I hit him with the mirror. And he says, all right, we've got you. And that was our first sign of some kind of relief. You know, okay, now they've got eyes on us.
There's some hope.
There is some hope. So they went back around, and they took a little while, and then they called us, and they said, we are going, we're coming back in, and we're going to drop a McGuire rig.
Which is?
A McGuire rig was developed by, I can't remember if he was a lieutenant or a captain. He was an officer. His last name is McGuire. And it's a rope that's roughly about 150 feet long. And at the end of that rope is two leg loops, and then just above it a few feet is a hand loop, and then about 10 feet higher is another two leg loops, and above that is another hand loop. And they said, we're going to wait, we're going to throw a McGuire rig down on each side of the helicopter. We're going to weight them down with ammo cans, and you guys get in there as quick as you can. Which meant,
by the way, were there four of you?
There was four of us, so it was going to take.
Mm-hmm. Who gets to go first?
Well, whoever gets the
fight over
first.
That. Huh? Of course, being first might not be such a good idea. Anyway,
I know.
Go ahead.
Yeah. So anyway, we thought, well, here we go, you know, because it's going to take us time to get jump in those and get situated. And of course, we had our D-rings that we always carry, our carabiners, you know.
What are they?
The carabiners, what mountain climbers use.
Oh, okay.
Okay,
uh-huh, okay.
With the spring gate to them. Mm-hmm. We each carried one of those, and we carried a Swiss seat of an 8-foot rope. Each one of us carried that we would actually tie. Back then, we didn't have.
Why would you have those in the first place? Because climbing
for rappelling.
Okay. Oh, okay.
Repelling
gotcha.
Out of helicopters,
gotcha.
Repelling down mountains, or
gotcha.
That sort of thing. So
gotcha.
Each one of us carried one of those. Back then, like I say, we had to tie our own Swiss seats.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they didn't make them like they do these days, you know, the nice ones. But anyway, they worked. But so anyway, here come the helicopter, and he flew right over top of us, and the door gunners kicked out the ammo cans, and the ropes came down, and so we jumped and ran for the ropes. And the first thing, the guy sitting right next to me was Bill Fowler, okay? He jumped, and he got to our rope first. It had gotten tangled up around the bamboo and some limbs, and he was over there tugging on that thing. And I got up, and I was kind of slow because I had no feeling in my legs and my feet. I didn't know whether I could even walk, but I was able to get over there. And on the way over to help him untie the or yank this McGuire rig loose from all of its entanglement, I looked to my left, and I saw the team leader and the other guy from Pennsylvania, I forgot his name, but anyway, they were standing there. We were being shot at this mm-hmm. time because the enemy could see us by this time. I looked over as I was trying to make it to Bill. I looked over, and those two guys are standing there shaking hands.
Oh.
And I'll never forget that. They were just turned to each other and shook their hands. Like they kind of figured that was it. They were not going to get out of that alive. It wasn't congratulating. They were just saying like goodbye. Because
but you two, everybody was supposed to be rescued, but they figured you two were going to be on your way, and that was it. Am I reading?
No, they figured they were going to get shot dead. They figured we were all going to get shot dead before we could even get on the ropes and get out of there.
I got you.
Because there was a lot of ammunition being fired at us, and it was zinging and bouncing everywhere.
So they were just basically giving up at that point.
They were.
Yeah.
They were just saying goodbye to each other. And I turned, and Bill was yanking on this line, and so I grabbed it, and we broke it loose, and he got in the top, and I got in the bottom set, and the other guys by that time had already jumped in theirs, and we signaled them to go, and they lifted us up, and we started shooting because, you know, we're just hanging on to our weapon and hanging on to one hand, and we thought, you know, least we can do is throw a few more rounds at them.
One last hurrah.
Yeah, one last hurrah. So we were kind of strafing them, and ship went up, and then all of a sudden it was out over this. The ground dropped away from us, and all of a sudden we were at like 1,200 feet, and they flew us 30 miles back, playing wrong fire base. And I remember looking back,
man,
looking back at that mountain, and those gunships never stopped. Those Cobras
they
just kept going. They were still back there raising hell. They weren't going to leave until they were empty, you know. And they were just, I mean, it was like the whole top of that mountain was white. And I thought, Jesus, we actually got out of there.
It is a miracle.
Because of these guys above us. And then I remember looking up, and as I looked up, I saw the one door gunner got out of his seat and was laying down, and he was watching us, and he was waving at us. Mm-hmm. And the chase ship that was up above us during all this, mm-hmm. well, they zoomed in and came around, and they were flying around us all the way back, because at that point they didn't know had any of us been hit.
Oh, mm-hmm.
Were we wounded? Were we going to fall out of that rope, or what was the deal? Yeah. But we were just, you know, trying to wave at them and hang on to a gun at the same time, you know, and it's like, oh my
well,
God.
I'm trying to visualize. Now, you were pulled into the helicopter.
No.
You were still swinging?
Yeah, they couldn't pull us in, not two guys. I mean,
oh,
they didn't have any winch.
Gosh.
Yeah.
How far away pictures. From the door were you?
150 feet from where I was, the bottom. Yeah, the line, the rope was 150 feet long.
So you were just in swinging in the air?
Just riding along like that, four of us. That's what those pictures are right there.
And
miles.
How far did you go?
30 miles at 1,200 feet.
It's like a Disney ride.
Oh, it was. It was like, man, this is great, you know?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand. You did not get inside the helicopter.
They couldn't pull us up because they had no winches or anything, and there's no way even two guys could pull another two guys up.
Were you secure enough?
Well, we had
roped in?
We had our legs through the two loops, and we're hanging on to one loop.
Yeah, so pretty secure.
Pretty secure.
Okay, I have to know how they landed you.
Well, they brought us in and just very gently set us down. And, you know, when they brought us into the fire base, I'll never forget.
Was that same fire base?
Flamerong fire base, 30 miles away, yeah. They took us right there.
They probably could not believe it.
They could not. And that whole operation generated so much interest. We had brass coming from everywhere. They just converged on Plamorong. Their choppers were flying these guys in from everywhere because everybody wanted to know, what in the hell did these guys run into?
No kidding.
They wanted to know. They had an idea that this movement was going to happen, but they wanted firsthand information. And I remember looking down as the chopper was flying in and started lowering us down, and it just looked like there were just hundreds of people that were milling around underneath us, ready to get a hold of us.
And tell me, how was your little homecoming there? What did they do? Did they take you to the command center?
The command center on that fire base was three 113 track vehicles. These track vehicles are big. They're kind of a big square track. They don't use them anymore, but they're just full of radios, all kinds of radio equipment, all kinds of communication and other equipment. And they had three of them backed up to each other, and they had a big, like a troop tent set over top of it. Mm-hmm. So it was like walking into a tent.
Mm-hmm.
And then here were these big tracks with their big doors laid down like that off of the their ass end of them like that. And, you know, they're all lit up and guys are inside and there was brass all over the place. And there was, I don't remember seeing a general there, but there were lots of colonels, full bird, light bird colonels, lots of captains, you know, lots and lots of brass. I don't remember actually seeing a general. There might have been a one star around there. I don't know. But
okay, and had they come in when all of this started happening, or when did, was everybody just kind of arriving at different times to make this observation of what was going on?
Well, apparently these people weren't, they weren't indigenous to the fire base. Mm-hmm. A few of them were, that were actually operating that fire base and running things. But the big brass were coming in from Pleiku, they were coming in from other locations, I guess.
What did they do with you when you got on your feet?
When they got it, well, these guys, you know, they had a lot of regular troops that were manning that base that ran in there, and they got a hold of us, and they were shaking us off and making sure, you know, they were looking to, I think they were looking to see if any of us had been shot.
Well, yeah,
you know, or
and
hurt.
You were in pretty good condition for the condition you were in.
We were in perfect condition. Not a single one of us had even taken one round. Not a single round.
That's amazing.
It was amazing. And, you know, they got us out of the ropes, and they were giving us water, and canteens were coming from everywhere. You
How
know,
about
and
steak?
And a few, well, didn't no food, but these guys were trying to give us, getting us rehydrated, you know.
Absolutely.
And because those line guys know, you know, when you're in something like that, you don't have time to drink water, you know. Mm-hmm. And when you're in a situation like that, anyway, they were trying to make sure we were okay, and then they led us up to the command center, and I remember there were a couple of benches, like park benches, inside this command center along the edges, and we went in there, and there was a couple of light birds, a couple of full birds that were in there. And one guy kind of told us, he said, okay, we're going to give you guys some time to sit down and regroup, because we were just like this. We were just really, really rattled. We were shook up, you know.
Yeah.
And we were very thirsty. I just could not drink enough. And I remember I drank so much water and then some pop. And it's kind of funny, one of the officers told another guy, he said, go get these guys a beer. Mm-hmm. Bring them some beer. So this guy took off, and a little bit here, just a few minutes later, he came back in with a six pack of root beer. And so we opened those up, and that officer came over and he said, what the hell is this? He said, get rid of that shit. He says, I told you to bring these guys some beer, for Christ's sake. So this guy runs out, he comes back with a couple of six packs of beer, you know. So we're going, well, this is good, you know, we're gonna drink some beer here now, you know. This
is, that's champagne.
Yeah, this is life. So
how long did you stay there then? That was it, kind of a, they let you settle down, a little bit of debriefing going on?
They let us settle down, and then they started questioning us. They gave us a good 20 minutes, 30 minutes to get the jitters away, where we could talk without our teeth chattering, you know.
Yes.
And then they started questioning us. And
did they take you on back to the main, was it Pleiku after
Pleiku,
that?
They did, yeah.
And then was that it for you guys then?
Well, no, they flew us back to Pleiku, and the team leader and the assistant team leader went on up, and they had their breakdown with the G2 and the S3 people. Mm-hmm. And gave them all their information, and then everything settled down for us.
But you know, Gary, in assessing this, because you were out there as LRFs, as recons, you saw all the activity, you think about a 1,500 casualties out of this. Is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, the way that turned, the way that came about was, it was about, I think I took a couple of days off and then went back out on another mission. And then came back in after that mission, and then took another couple days, and then went back out on another mission, and then came back off of that mission, and I was on a stand down when we were actually out playing baseball there on the compound, and we saw an officer pushing another officer in a wheelchair. They got him out of a vehicle, and we saw him pushing him into our LRP compound. And the only people that ever were allowed in LRP compound were other LRPs and our chopper support. And we thought, well, what is this? So we stopped the game and walked over, and it was an officer that was bringing the helicopter pilot that got us out of there. He was in a wheelchair. This was a couple of weeks later. He'd been up at the 71st Medevac. When he brought that ship in, he took a round through that plexiglass landing port on his chopper, and it went up into his spine. And he was on his way to the Army hospital in Tokyo, where I was eventually medevaced. And he brought us each four photographs somebody had taken when they were bringing us in on the ropes. They took four pictures, and then they had copies made for each of us, and he brought them to us, and he wanted to see us personally. And we, at that point, we didn't even know that he had been shot. We had no idea.
This is pretty emotional, isn't
it? It was very emotional. Mm-hmm. Here, this officer had gone through this to get us out of there. And in talking with him and the other intelligence officer that had brought him down there, they were the ones that told us that our team had been given an estimated 1,500 body count. And we said, that many? And they said that for the 2 weeks that they had been flying high altitude recon, photographing the enemy, carrying their bodies, they're dead out of that, off of that mountain range.
It's just out of a movie. It really is. Just amazing.
It kind of is like a movie to us.
It is a
movie.
But, well, Gary, did you ever, you had about a month or so to go before coming home.
No, that was in July. That was in July.
Oh, that was from April to July.
April to July.
Some months to go.
I had
yet.
Some months to go. So I went through other missions. I ended up with 47 missions.
Why did they allow you to go back out again?
Well,
after all that?
That was our job. But what had happened, it was not too long after that, the CEO, Captain Cyberlane, came to me, and he said, no, actually he didn't come to me, he sent for me, and I went into his office, and he said, we have to take you out of the field. And I said, why? And he said, well, new orders are coming down that special ops units are having trouble with the guys, are having emotional problems. It's causing a lot of problems after they're going home, going back to base camp, or back to stateside service. And so he said, I'm going to give you, I was at the time, I was a Sergeant E5. He says, I'm going to give you one rocker stripe, make you an E6. And he says, I want you to take the job as Operations Sergeant. And he says, if you stick with it, everything works out. He said, by the time you go home, I guarantee you a second rocker.
Fair enough.
And I said, well, I don't want to do that. I don't want to leave my team. And he said, you don't have a choice. These are the orders. So I said, well, I already knew that Captain Siverling had become a very personal friend of mine. You know, he would take money and out of my winnings in our nightly poker games and stuff it in his pocket and save it for me when I'd be, rather than losing it in a poker game. You know,
that's a friend.
Yeah, that was a friend. But anyway, I said, well, I'll give it a try. And so he said, fine. And so I went out as Operations Sergeant. I went out the next day and inserted two teams and came back in. I said, I quit. I ain't doing it.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
I said, I'm going back to the teams. And he says, you can't. I said, you don't have a choice. You don't have any team leaders. I said, everybody's going home or getting hurt. And at that time, even the brigade LERP units that were based at Kontum and Dokto and Bamitu and places like that, there were brigade LERPs that were out. See, I was within division headquarter and headquarter LERPs. Mm-hmm. And that was the reason why I was accumulating so many missions, because I got to the point where I would come in and either take another team back out after I regrouped, took a shower and regrouped, re-outfitted myself, or if Cy didn't have any teams going out, then he would call around and find maybe a brigade team that needed a team leader. So I would jump a helicopter and I'd fly up to one of those places and do a mission of those guys. So I was accumulating a lot more missions, because the average amount of missions in 12 months was 45 missions. And I ended up at 47 in just a little under 10 months.
And but you describing, I have to get back out, that is such a classic emotional bonding with your buddies.
Yeah. You know, in the line units, we had friends that were in line units, but we didn't operate with the line units. The line units, those guys were losing so many people all of the time that they got to the point where, as most everybody knows, that when a new guy came into the unit, they kind of put him off. They didn't want to make friends because they didn't want to lose any more friends. In our unit, we were such a tight-knit, close operating, you know, three and four of us, five of us. We were very close.
Band of brothers.
Yes.
And, close band of brothers.
And I told him, I said, I'm going back out.
Mm-hmm. Well, eventually you came back in permanently.
Eventually I came back in on another mission that was actually into Laos, right on the trails. Mm-hmm. And we got into some trouble. And that, I got the guys out. That was for that one award I got, that mission. That was my last mission. I got the guys out. That was another mission where it wasn't so much an ambush mission, it was a photograph mission. See, we carried cameras with us and we took pictures.
Uh-huh.
And they wanted more information on what was going on the trails. That is the Ho Chi Minh trails. And we got within arm's reach of, I don't know, there's 30 or 40 of them. We took pictures of them. And that ended up, we got away from them, crossed the trail, and got in to where we were going to rest a little, and then we were going to set up and do more photographing and more reconning, and we got compromised. And that ended up, I got the guys out of there. We ran a long, long ways. We had a lot of people after us. But we got on the helicopter, and that was my last mission. I
wasn't it kind of deja vu all over again, experiencing that?
Well, there was so much of it. Yeah, I would think so. But it on that last mission, I got on the chopper. I was sitting next to the door. One leg hanging out, just kind of rattled. I remember back then I smoked, and of course we didn't smoke out in the field, but I remember I got a cigarette out, and then I couldn't find a match, couldn't find a lighter, and I was too rattled, and the door gunner had pulled out his lighter and he handed it to me. And I remember looking at it. There was something written on it. I remember lighting my cigarette, and then I closed the lid of that and I pitched it out the door like it was a match. And then I realized what I'd done, and I looked up at the door gunner, and he just smiled at me and shook his head and just turned around and took a hold of his gun and his machine gun, his M60. And,
he understood.
He understood. And it was 3 days later that I woke up, and I was in Yokohama, Japan, in the hospital.
Just a breakdown?
I just broke down, yeah. I just blacked out. And they said it was because of the that part of my brain, all the things that had been going on during all that time, the fear, I'm sure, the constant fear, the constant alertness, the adrenaline.
Hyperactivity.
The hyperactivity that my brain had kicked into 100% adrenaline 24/7, and it just knocked me for a loop. And the only thing I remember was what I called for years, I called it a blue dream, a dream with a blue haze, and some crying and screaming and that sort of thing. And but they told me in Yokohama that was all the people surrounded me on that aircraft. We were all dressed in blue pajamas.
Interesting.
The screaming and all that were the guys that were headed to the hospitals and that were wounded, you know. But that's
the power of the mind.
It's amazing.
It is. Well, you spent some time. By the way, while all this is going on, were you having much communication with your relatives, your wife back home? Or is it just few and far between?
Few and far between. Mm-hmm. I was so busy at what I was doing. It was few and far between. I wrote her a lot of letters. I wrote my mother, my brother letters. But
probably superficial letters.
Superficial. There was a lot that, being with a special ops unit like that, there's only so much that you can say anyway. I wouldn't say it's like top secret. It wasn't anything like that, but we
not
were cautioned. We were cautioned, do not send total dialogues to your people, because you're just going to scare the hell out of them.
Exactly.
So
they wouldn't get it.
They wouldn't get it, and there's a lot that they still don't know.
Of course, right. Well, moving then toward, okay, you're in Yokohama for a while. Were you transferred to a military hospital in the United States then after that?
No. I was in Yokohama for about 3.5 months. Mm-hmm. They were going to give me a medical discharge. They came and said, we are going to, we decided we're going to give you a medical discharge. Mm-hmm. And I said, no. I refused. I said no. Mm-hmm. what I want you to do is send me back to Vietnam.
I need to go back to my
Yes, I need to get back with my team, my people. That's all I knew.
Classic response.
I wasn't done with the military. I still had time left. I didn't want to go stateside. Mm-hmm. If I'm going to do something, I want to be there, you know.
And they said.
No, yeah. You're not going to go. And I fought.
They've heard that response before,
oh,
Gary.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah. And it was, in a way, I should have taken the medical discharge. It would have helped me a lot. But at the time, I was afraid that nobody would hire me.
Exactly. You're still a young kid.
Yeah, how am I going to? And back then, they didn't have the time or the personnel to actually sit down and counsel you with all this information.
Exactly.
They were learning, you know, but they were still learning from the Korean War.
Exactly.
And World War II.
That's right. So did you get the medical discharge, or did you come back to the States and serve out your time?
I came back to the States and served out some time. I started getting into trouble back in the States because they put me in a unit that I knew, like a mobile radar unit. Mm-hmm. I knew nothing about mobile radar. All I knew at that point, I knew how to drive a tanker truck, I knew how to drive tanks, but I mostly knew recon and ambush.
And bored and unsettled.
Bored to death. Mm-hmm. And they said, you're in charge, you're the sergeant, you're in charge of the platoon. So you talk with the platoon. And the platoon came and they said, they're, you know, each squad had a leader. And they said, you don't know anything about what we're doing, so you just leave it alone. You don't touch the equipment. You don't know anything about it. Mm-hmm. And the medic for that unit came and said, my job is to make sure that you take your medication.
For everybody's sake.
Yeah. And I said, I don't want to do this. So I went to the CO. I said, you've got to cut me orders, send me back to Vietnam. They said, they're not going to take it. Yeah. You're here.
Yeah.
So unfortunately, I started getting into trouble.
Yeah. No surprise.
I started getting into trouble. And and eventually, one thing led to another, and I was incarcerated. I went AWOL for 4 days. I thought, I've run my gauntlet. I'm at the end of my rope. I need to do something to make these people understand that I mean business. Well, being as young as I was, I didn't know anything.
Sure.
But I thought I did.
Sure. But, you know, they had to see all of your, didn't they understand the symptoms?
No. I don't think they, because nobody, they just said, take your medication, leave us alone. You know.
And that's tragic, and it's tragic.
So.
But so you ended in the brink for a little while.
I went AWOL for 4 days. Mm-hmm. I went down to Phoenix, Arizona. And with another guy that he lived down there, and he said, well, let's just take off to Phoenix. And I said, all right, we'll go down there. So I took off, and it just happened when I got there, I called my mother, because I was afraid, well, they're going to call her and she's going to get worried. So I called her and I said, I'm in Phoenix and I'm AWOL, but I'm trying to get back to Vietnam, and this is how I'm trying to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to shake up the people in the right positions.
She probably couldn't understand it.
She couldn't, and it was funny because she said, my God, you're in Phoenix. Your stepfather is in Phoenix.
Oh my gosh. Hmm.
He was a Southeastern District Manager for Waring, or was it Waring Corporation? Anyway, a corporation, and so he was in Phoenix at a big convention. She said, call him. So I called and left a message, and then he eventually called me back, and he said, you come out here to the convention, I need to talk to you. Well, he was an ex-Marine.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went and saw him, and we had dinner, and he said, you spend the night with me. He says, but he says, son, you got to go back. I said, I know I got to go back, that's my plan.
Mm-hmm.
He He said, well, you head back out there tomorrow. He said, the longer you stay out, the worse it's going to get. I said, well, I know it. So I went back. I left that other guy there. I don't know whatever happened to him. So I went back.
He's on his own.
He's on his own. So I went back. I drove all the way back. And I remember I arrived at, I was in Fort Carson. That's where they sent me, Fort Carson, Colorado. Mm-hmm. So I got to Fort Carson. I got to the front gate, and I said, okay, I'm AWOL. Well, they were going to throw the cuffs on me at that time. And I said, no, you don't need to do that. I said, I brought myself back. That's, well, I'm going to go to the CO and talk to him. Mm-hmm. He said, okay, you go ahead, but we're going to call the rest of the gates and make sure you don't get back out. I said, that's fine. So I went back. I saw the CO, and he immediately put me under house arrest. Mm-hmm. And they formed a special courts martial. And I waited for, I don't know, it seemed to me like a week. And they put together this special court martial in the day room. And I remember waiting because there was a young man, a little black Negro fellow, that was in there being tried. And he came out and he sat down. And I remember I said, well, what did you do and what did they do? And he said, well, I've been AWOL for 9 months. Mm. And he said, I went AWOL from my induction station. Mm. And he said, they're just going to send me on to the other side of the base, and whatever they do, I guess I'm going to start all over. And I said, well, all right. I thought, well, I've got her made then.
Yeah, no kidding.
Well, little did I know, I didn't have it made. So they called me, and I got to the door, and there was a second lieutenant that opened the door for me. And then he stopped me, and he said, you can't wear your medals. Hmm. I was in my dress greens. Hmm. I said, what do you mean I can't wear my medals? He said, you can't wear them into this trial. Well, I didn't know any better, but that was a load of bull. But I took them off and gave them to him, and he took them and he stuck them in my breast or my pocket here on the dress greens. And I walked in there, and 15 minutes later, I was in the back of a Jeep headed for the stockade. Mm-hmm. Busted. They took two-thirds of my pay and sentenced me to 6 months of hard labor.
Did you serve that time?
I served 57 days, which at that time of our era here in the country, there was a lot of racial mm-hmm. problems, and it was real bad in the stockade. There were people getting beat up daily. We were running gauntlets, being beat on as we would leave the mess hall. And it finally came to an end where they broke in to our barracks, got through the downstairs guard. They went upstairs, broke in, overpowered that guard, and broke into that gate and went in and tied, I don't know, they had something, get somebody up there, but they tied that guy to his mattress and set him on fire, set the mattress and burned this guy up. And so the word got out, and we finally said, you know, we've got to put a stop to this. And so we all gathered at one corner of the compound, and we refused to allow this to continue. And so they called out all the MPs. They had a helicopter flying over top of the compound. They called all the MPs out, and they surrounded that entire compound with these guys in full riot gear. And then what they did is they separated us mm-hmm. and put us out in the back field. It was kind of a work area. But anyway, I stayed there, and then one day, 57 days later from the day I went in, a guard came and he said, you've got a friend out front from your company, he wants to talk to you. So I went to the front gate, and they opened the gate, and I said, well, what's going on? And he said, get in the Jeep. He says, the CO wants to see you. And I said, oh, good. I'm going back to Vietnam. They finally got the message.
Oh, yeah.
So he took me back to the gate, or from the gate to the CO, and I went in, and the CO was sitting there, and he had a piece of paper and he in front of him, and he spun it around like this and put a pen there, and he said, "Sign that." I said, "Okay." I said, "I'm signing my transfer. This is my transfer. I'm going back to Vietnam." He said, "Just sign it." I said, "Yes, sir." So I signed it. And he says, "All right." He says, "There's two sergeants outside." And I just happened to see him as I was going in to see this CO. And he said, "You go out there and get with these guys." I knew both of them. They were good friends. And he said, what are they going to do? And he said, "They're going to take you back to your room." I shared another room with another sergeant. And he said, "They're going to take you back to your room. You're under house arrest." And I said, "Well, then what?" He said, "Well, then in the morning, you're out of the Army. Mm. You're discharged." Mm. I said, "Mm. What do you mean I'm discharged? I thought I just signed transfer papers back." He said, "You signed just transfer papers right out of the service." Mm. I said, "What kind of a discharge?" Mm. He says, it's a general under honorable. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of funny because I got the Jeep. I was stunned. Because I really wanted to stay in the military.
I think I'm guessing they thought they were doing you a huge favor.
Yeah, because I knew I would not stop. Mm-hmm. I would not stop with my transfer requests.
Mm-hmm.
I
wanted and to I'm back. Guessing they thought this is your one-way ticket to get killed. Going back, I suppose.
The funny thing, I did not know this until when I got outside, I got in the Jeep, and these guys headed away from the office, they drove right by my barracks and kept on going. And I said, "What are you guys doing?" And one of them turned around and he said, "Sarge, we know you better. We know that you're not going to stay on this base one more night. You'll go AWOL again." And I said, "You damn right I will." And I said, "So where are we going?" They said, "We're going to take you downtown. We bought you a motel. We're going to give you some money. Go out, party, get drunk, do whatever you want to do, but be back." They took me to the hotel downtown. They said, "You'll be standing here at 6 o'clock in the morning. We're going to pick you up." And they gave me some money out of their pocket. And they said, "Go have some fun tonight. You earned it."
Good buddies.
Yep.
Good.
So the next day, I was there. They picked me up, took me back, mustered me out. However, they did not muster me through medical. And I did not realize for a long time that was one part that I was supposed to go through.
Was that?
Because you muster out through supply, mm-hmm. and finance, and medical, mm-hmm. And there's a couple other places that you have to go.
But you bypassed the medical.
They bypass my medical.
Yeah. Is it for a good reason?
Well, I don't know.
Yeah, you never know.
I don't know, but I know that there's been other people in the VA system, my counselors, that have asked me, you know, where is this information? Mm-hmm. Why is that missing? I said, well.
So Yokohama and all of that's missing from your records?
No, Yokohama's
that's
in there.
Uh-huh.
Yokohama's
yeah.
in there.
But not Fort Carson.
But you're supposed to muster uh-huh. out through uh-huh. from your last duty station check through medical. Check. They have to sign you off. Mm-hmm. But anyway, they put me on a plane and I flew back to Charlotte.
Mm-hmm. Was your wife sweating there for you?
No. My mother and my stepfather drove down from the town about 40, 50 miles away. And I think they wanted some time with me. They didn't want to shock my young wife.
Sure.
Because she was, at that time, she was studying there in Charlotte. Mm-hmm. She was studying to be a nurse. Mm-hmm. She's going to Piedmont Community College or whatever it was. But anyway, they came and picked me up and took me immediately to a restaurant, because at that time, I think I remember I weighed like 129 pounds.
I bet they were shocked to see you.
Mother was shocked. I remember she started crying. Mm-hmm. And then I found out that it wasn't the military that got me out. It was Senator James Broyhill.
Mm.
of the Broyhill Manufacturing. Back then, he was a senator of North Carolina. And she had written to him and said, there is something wrong. I didn't realize that, but I didn't know that she had written him. And she said, I'm not getting any letters. I don't know what's happened to my son. And he did a congressional investigation, found out what they'd done to him, and he said, you get him out. Get him out now.
You had people, you suffered, but you had people along the way.
I did.
Rescuing you in different parts of your young life.
Yeah.
Sure, you
yeah.
did. Well, to tie these last ends together, so did you... And I asked the question because so many did not remain married because of the youth and everything you went through. So did you hang in there?
With the marriage?
With the marriage.
The marriage lasted about another, a total of 6 years.
Well, that's pretty
another
good.
5 years.
Yeah, all things considered.
Well, I went into, I started driving semi. And I started doing what everybody else does, going from one job to another, mostly sticking with semi, but then I became a police officer. Mm-hmm. And I realized fairly soon after I started that I was too itchy. It was not a good fit for me because I didn't realize I was suffering from PTSD.
Oh, no
I had
question.
No idea. But I knew something was wrong, and I was not in a good fit with the police force.
Probably the adrenaline was still flowing.
Oh, it was. Mm-hmm. The adrenaline was flowing. My counselor says adrenaline, and she's the only one right here in Walla Walla after all the years mm-hmm. Of the different medical people that I've seen with the VA system, she's the only one. Dr. McDonald, mm-hmm. Is that her name? Donald, anyway, I can't remember, I'm talking too much anyway, but my counselor here says...
Identified it.
She identified it, and so now I wear a patch on my on my shoulder that I have to keep on. Mm. It's clonidine, it's the strongest clonidine patch that they make, that prescription.
And that reduces the adrenaline highs?
It reduces the adrenaline. Mm-hmm. to a level that I can function.
Wow, you had a lot of suffering. So through the years, you classic going from job to job like so many did.
Well, yeah, you know, I work as a police officer twice, kind of back to back, and mostly driving semi. Then because I wanted to stay away from people, mm-hmm. wanted to be by myself, and then. The adrenaline got to be too much, so I got out of that. I got into underwater salvage. Mm-hmm. Worked in Puget Sound up in Alaska for a while until I got injured under a boat up there. Mm-hmm. And then I traded my... I still have more diving equipment, but I traded that equipment and then bought skydiving equipment, and I started, I learned to skydive, and then I ended up teaching skydiving for 21 years.
How many?
21 years.
And you told me how many jumps?
30, a little over 3,400 jumps.
Yeah. What do you think, Vic?
Yeah, I've got a little over 3,400, 3,420 or something, whatever's in my logbooks.
Live to talk about those too.
Yeah.
Well, anyway, in the very few minutes, it's just been an absolutely riveting story. You ended up in Walla Walla.
Uh-huh.
Job, friend, how many years here?
Oh, I've been in Walla Walla now for... 12 years or so, 13 years. I've been through two marriages. The first one lasted 5 years, 6 years. The second one lasted 22 years. And now I've been with my Helen now for going on 18 years.
18 years?
Yeah. We're not married.
Yeah, but she sounds like a great friend.
She is. She's 17 years younger than I am. Very intelligent young lady, works over here at Whitman College. She has she's an assistant director of alumni funds over there. And she's, yeah, we've done a lot. She's always made sure that on Veterans Day, something is done.
Excellent, as it should be.
She took me, she flew me and herself on her dime back to the Vietnam Veterans Wall back in D.C. We spent 10 days back there. And
did you handle it okay?
I handled it pretty good, yeah, pretty good.
That could be a tough one.
Yeah, it was tough, but I intend to go back.
Are you going to go back again?
Oh, yes, uh-huh. Yeah.
Good. This time. How about under that thunder roll? Don't they have the big thunder roll? Have you thought about
rolling
that?
Thunder?
Rolling thunder.
Yeah, I would like to, one of these days, I would like to jump on that one.
That
because,
would be the icing on the cake.
Yeah, I'm retired now. You know, I came back. Well, we went to Vegas and where I taught skydiving, doing tandem jumps down at Skydive Las Vegas, and she worked as a Japanese interpreter down there with the company. But we eventually came back here, and she went to work for the college, and I eventually retrained myself through VA Voc Rehab, and became a medical laboratory technician and a phlebotomist. I went to work for the VA, and now I'm retired.
Excellent, and it's not over with yet.
No, it's not.
No.
I still support. You know, I ride with the Combat Veterans International Group.
And a great, you know, group they are.
Yeah.
I love those combat veterans. Oh. They support the veterans fabulously.
Yes, we do support them.
Oh, you do a great job. I know that firsthand. So, just in your retirement, so you're obviously involved with the type of veterans organization, and any hobbies, interests that you're doing right now? Any more skydiving?
Well, no. I haven't done any jumping there for, I don't know, it's been a number of years now. The guys that I was working for, they retired and sold all their equipment, and at that point, I thought, well, I'd have to travel 100 plus miles to go make a jump, and I've already got plenty, so I started putting my interest more into motorcycles and boats.
Excellent outlets.
So
you keep on moving.
Oh yes, absolutely.
You got those engines going all the time.
Adrenaline's still pumping.
Yeah, oh boy, I tell you, do you, Vic, do you have anything to?
No.
Okay. Whew. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
I got so wordy.
Oh, I was riveted. We were riveted to your story. I guess one of my last comments, I just hope that these stories are listened to down through the generations to, now I get emotional, to have a full appreciation of your combat sacrifice experience for what I continue to think was a noble cause. I don't care what anybody says. It was a noble cause.
I'd do it again. I have no regrets.
I believe it. I know a Vietnamese that thanks you, all of you, for 10 more years of his life without communism. That's
wow.
A huge deal.
That is huge.
Yeah, and he told me that.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, he lives in Prescott, Arizona.
Really?
And he goes around the veterans group thanking them as often as he can.
That is neat.
Yes.
That's wonderful.